So welcome everyone, I'm Daniel. Probably some of you already saw me last year in Battlemesh where I did a first attempt of packaging Gnunet. So what is Gnunet and why the hell would you even bother of something more advanced than what we currently got? Because it looks like a lot of overhead if you take a first look at it. And so I think what I want to do now is less of a technical talk, because last year I kind of introduced the technical background. There's tons of material about Gnunet, tons of existing talks introducing the different subsystems, and many of the developers have been to a lot of conferences. So I now want to specifically focus on why should mesh communities be bothered with something which sounds like peer-to-peer, and usually that sounds not intuitive. So why do I bother? Because the current mesh reality goes far beyond just routing algorithms and optimizing some wireless drivers, and in our everyday reality of how these community networks look like, we find laggy and very costly centralized VPNs, so the different non-wirelessly connected islands somehow communicate. So that requires central infrastructure, and thus contradicts the idea of creating a decentralized network. Also, we have evil firewall and network address translation, which kind of makes us to second-class internet users, because, you know, even home users, they can use nasty things like UPnP to open up external ports, but if you access the internet through a community mesh network, usually you can only establish outgoing connections to the ARPANET, and you can't open up ports unless you're lucky and you live in Austria and you have a public IP version 4 address on your router, but that comes with another set of less funny things. And another thing is we lack a naming system. And you know, the answer to this is usually, yeah, well, just use 8.8.8.8. So, but it has a lot of disadvantages, because it, first of all, creates a dependency towards one centralized service provider. Just imagine they would switch that one off. We don't hope that it will happen, but it might happen eventually one day. And then we have this static piece of configuration on a lot of devices, and we will end up in a jungle of IP tables rules to catch them and redirect them and do even more nasty things. And that's just the technical side of it. On another hand, Google, who operates that name server, obviously collects a lot of statistics and data about the use of it, because that's why they run it. So it kind of makes us the product being sold and harvested by Google, which, you know, it could be a legitimate consideration, because they give us something for it. But in a way, I think we could do better. We could come up with a naming system which also allows naming inside the mesh network. And you know, OLSR kind of allows to, OLSR v1 kind of allows to integrate that a little bit, but it becomes a lot of overhead, because you store the whole list of all nodes and their names on every single system and not based on the demand when it's queried. Another thing is obviously 8.8.8.8 just being the obvious example, but mesh networks don't give you any privacy in terms of your traffic not being easy to monitor and to map to a specific client device. I will come to that later, which puts you in a position which is probably worse than the average user of a commercial ISP. The usual answer is, yeah, well, if you need privacy, just use Tor. Again, I'm not very satisfied to hear that, because Tor also depends on a centralized directory server on the internet and cannot be used autonomously inside a mesh infrastructure. So that also that's also not a good solution and creates external dependencies I'm not happy with, and I think nobody should be very happy with. So concluding, we can say that security and privacy in contemporary community mesh networks obviously depends on a lot of personal awareness of the specific individual user and on a lot of knowledge and manual configuration. So you really have to want it, and you have to put a lot of effort into enjoying basic anonymity, or at least location anonymity, or not making it very obvious where your device does what. So people can use MAC changer, obviously, or they can use DNS script to encrypt their DNS traffic if they have a DNS script server hosted somewhere, obviously. And they commonly use Tor and VPNs to go around that. But you know, this then depends on the individual users, and it's all basically traffic going out to services on ARPA internet. It's not things we do inside the mesh, except for a MAC changer. But it again creates dependencies. So most routing protocols, unfortunately, don't have any built-in security model. I think the current only exception is BMX7, as far as I'm aware of, which at least signs routing originators. So in that way, at least it's not vulnerable to denial of service attacks for a whole network from a single point. But however, it still doesn't secure your traffic. It uses the usual IP routing paradigms, which is basically what's outside of the envelope. The communication metadata remains unchanged during transit, which allows collecting that metadata at an arbitrary point, basically. Sorry? Sorry?
Just pointing that I think in BMX7, the data, the user data is also encrypted, so.
The traffic itself is also being encrypted?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's good, I didn't know that. Good to hear, thank you. Maybe switch it off. So denial of service or inserting malicious rule routes is pretty trivial in most protocols except BMX7. So what I want to do now is a comparison, just from a very basic user perspective, of what happens when I'm using a community mesh versus what happens if I'm a regular customer of a commercial ISP from a security and privacy perspective. And when accessing things on the web, which, you know, unfortunately, it's the most popular and sometimes only application of most community mesh networks, which is a sad thing. I just heard from Linux that they actually do have some internal services. I know that many Python communities at least started at some point, and some of them died again, to have some internal services. But most of them were also not truly distributed services. It were just, you know, you would just run a web server at some point being accessible from an address inside the mesh. So you would, you know, just offload it from the gateway, basically. Yeah, exactly. Gonna hope somebody will find it. So basically, if you use a community mesh network, and most of them, if you access a service on the web, the traffic either, in very rare cases, is still routed through individuals' shared internet connections. But in most cases, it's routed through a small set of VPNs, which source address then you obviously inherit. That creates a problem because this source address, an IP version 4 address, is never shuffled, unlike usual ISP consumer internet, where you get a new address every 24 hours. So this is not only bad from a privacy point of view, it's also bad because if there's a single client inside your network which starts participating unknowingly in a distributed denial of service attack, you're going to end up on all kinds of blacklists. And you know, we have a lot of bug tickets showing up in our Freifunk network, which says, oh, I can't access this commercial website anymore. And then we look and we realize, oh, Cloudflare is blocking us, or Razer is blocking us. How did that happen? And we can't tell, and you know, but we have to care about it. It won't just go away after 24 hours, but we are now the ones to do all the abuse handling, which obviously is also a disadvantage. You know, the commercial ISP, you have a dynamic address, and only the ISP can map the dynamic address you have to your user account. While on the mesh, kind of everyone on the way could potentially do that. So also another thing is like how much data about the clients propagates outside of your administrative domain. So usually if you have a normal commercial ISP, you have a router, which might be even your own router, and thus information about your local clients, their MAC addresses, which basically it's the serial number, it's a unique identifier of a device, never leaves your local administrative domain, hopefully at least. Yes? I'm saying hopefully because I'm aware that, of course, with like panopticlick style and browser fingerprinting, we're all lost anyway. But, you know, at least the MAC address, it stays local. While in some community networks, which route on layer 2, the MAC addresses and DHCP leases, which also contain the host name and another global identifier and many other details about a specific client, end up on a server somewhere in the cloud, which is a central piece of infrastructure, pretty easy to monitor or infiltrate. It's a target. And, you know, I wouldn't want to be the one having an access to this because I wouldn't sleep though, because I would have to take care that my SSH key doesn't get compromised. It's a powerful position and comes with a lot of responsibility, obviously. Well, as I said, all other users may easily intercept or even maliciously reroute traffic in typical today's routing protocols, which all depend on trust inside the network, which is something, if you have the network entirely open for everyone to join, you might not know if there's some bad people among. So that's another problem. Well, on the commercial ISP side, it's not that much better, but at least they pretend to govern the routing rules, but in practice, because of how BGP works, and we saw that in the Snowden leaks, practically every big entity, any core ISP could reroute or announce some addresses and intercept traffic, which is also very bad. And another thing is how accessible is the network and who decides or what decides over privileges inside the network. So in typical community mesh networks, we have some kind of informal hierarchies because people created it and thus know the tricky bits or have the right access rights to give themselves more privileges than others. But it's mostly also the knowledge gap. It's just because some people are technically more advanced, then they know how to get more of the cake, and others which are not so advanced get less. In a corporate setting, obviously, the corporate hierarchies and interest for profit, you know, the more you pay, the more you get, ideally, decide over how much you get. So I introduced some coloring scheme because last time I was criticized that my slides don't have enough colorful things and I use this traffic light scheme. It might be a little bit ideologically biased, but for me it looks like that. Where are we on the map? Like, why should we be bothered as community networks? We might just say this is not our problem. These are problems which are all over the internet. It's not my department, you could say. But in a way, this is true. But also, there was this effort to make a map of all the typical internet technologies and their implications for privacy and security. You can see that it's youbroketheinternet.org, and there they have this huge poster showing all types of technology. I know that it's too small to read it. I knew that you couldn't read it. That's why I made it a bit larger, the relevant part for us at least. And you can see we are here. This is OpenWRT, LibreCMC. Now you would put lead here. And you know, the routing protocols, Batman and OLS are being very easy to infiltrate, monitor, or maliciously manipulate, while BMX 7 at least has some security. So somehow, by looking at this whole problem, I had an enlightenment. I thought maybe services inside mesh structures could be implemented in a fundamentally different way than the centralized services we see today. If we only try to be like an extension of the lowest level of the pyramid and just extend it a little bit more to the bottom, like what will be the potential impact? I don't see that could have a lot of impact. If one might make things a little bit cheaper, or how to say, give more market incentives for ISPs if stuff becomes too ubiquitous. But in a way, I would hope to see fundamentally different architecture inside mesh structures as compared to cloud services, also because, like, as the Linux guy said in the talk, it will become very difficult to achieve decent uptime and reliability if we count on centralized structures. So because the current reality is basically we use Facebook to communicate with people next doors. So if the default route is failing, even though I have a direct route, like IP level route maybe, to that neighbor, we can't chat on Facebook anymore because the default route has just failed. And that's sad because we're missing out on something we could potentially have. So what we need is kind of the fault tolerance, graceful degradation, and everything the Erlang crowd was talking about for a long time, but somehow I failed to see how they deliver that outside of a very centrally managed domain, because they also count on X509, which I think is pretty broken because it, again, builds up centralized hierarchies, like you have one certification. It's X509 is basically SSL certificates, you would say, and certification authorities, because X509 kind of makes the implication that every public key which becomes a certificate has exactly one signer, which is the certification authority. This is unlike other models like the PGP Web of Trust, which also has a lot of problems, I don't want to say that, but which at least allows many signers. I know that X509 has an extension, like some version 3 extension, which now allows to have co-signers, but hardly any implementation would consider them, or, you know, it's just you have that field somewhere in the form, but no one ever looks at it. So, but this would allow building a web of trust based on X509, but no one ever did. So, another thing is DNS is broken, not only if you use it inside the mesh, because you have to set one DNS server and then it won't name your devices inside the mesh, but just, you know, forward it somehow to Google. But also in terms of security, DNS is unencrypted. It gives away a lot of information of what you're doing on the web. By only monitoring DNS traffic, you can make a very good assessment of what services are being used by whom at which time, only by looking at DNS, which is not a lot of data. Also, DNSSEC doesn't help that because DNSSEC basically just makes DNS spoofing harder while not giving any additional security in terms of your queries remaining private or anything like that. Also, the new top-level domains or any of the recent efforts in correlation to the domain name system won't help its fundamental brokenness. So what we need is a distributed naming system. So what I thought is, you know, why do we need autonomous distributed applications, you may ask? So if the default gateway fails, you know, go fix it. But in a way, to create a resilient infrastructure, it should be robust. It should not be easy to interfere with it. And of course, in the radio spectrum, you can always say you can locally interfere. You put your fingernail onto the door switch of a microwave oven and switch it on, and probably all microwave traffic is going to disappear in a quite large range. But that's still a local attack, and it's easy to prove after that that, oh, there was some event, we all observed it. So what I don't want to see is possibilities to maliciously intervene with mesh traffic undetected. So yes, you can break the glass, but you will leave a trace. That's okay. But it shouldn't be possible to break things without leaving traces of breaking. Then you could extend this list endlessly, obviously. So, you know, for inspiration, what would be the IoT light switch you could truly trust? You know, what properties would it need to have? And then, you know, you would say, yeah, well, I'm a geek. I will put my own operating system on it and it will sit somewhere behind my router. And, you know, I will solve it with some SSH tunneling, dun DNS, and all that stuff. But I kind of believe it won't scale.
Much easier. It would have a cable
connection to my router. Yes, yeah. In first place, you should have, just a wire would be okay. But saying that you really want to control your light switch from a remote location or with a mobile device, then, you know, why ever you would need that in first place is a different question. So probably, if you're thinking that, you know, I have this vague feeling that, you know, with port forwarding, UPnP, dun DNS, and SSH tunnels, that won't really scale. It will not really be useful and reliable in the way I would want it to be. So probably Gnunet or other secure peer-to-peer frameworks or overlay is what I'm or what you might be looking for. So I went around and I looked at a lot of different distributed VPNs and overlays, and I tried a couple of them, and they're very useful things going on in this area, but most of them operate on one or maximum two layers on the OSI model, which seems to be, like, according to the preaching of the OSI model, the right thing to do, that you want to keep those layers separate and you solve whatever transportation on through some VPN, but it doesn't do like service announcements or assessments towards security or privacy. The applications should take care of it. So basically, you always create models where you forward the responsibility into smaller and smaller parallel entities. Basically, on an application level, that means that every single application comes with its own bindings to a specific SSL TLS implementation, and you don't know if they even use it correctly. And whoever has ever looked, I did, into the code of an SSL library, there's a lot of pitfalls you can step into. For example, SSL verify, if you put that into an if and you test it in a simple way with a good and a bad certificate, then that will work. The problem is it outputs two if the certificate format is invalid, so that will also return true. And you would, you know, so it's easy to trick that, and if you don't design your tests carefully or read the specs carefully, you can do a lot of things wrong which are not obvious. And so leaving that to application developers seems like an obvious mistake, to me at least. So about peer-to-peer, I still see that there's fear in your eyes when I say that word. You know, it eats up bandwidth, it gives us legal trouble, I don't want that. But, you know, that might be coming from a perspective quite a while ago, and you might say, yeah, most peer-to-peer tools, when I tried them in a mesh environment, probably years ago, they didn't work well, or they, you know, people inside the mesh didn't communicate directly. They would go over all the way to the gateway and back, or they would not be able to communicate at all due to the lack of options to open external ports. And, you know, these frameworks were just not designed to be used in private networks. They were designed to be used on the public internet with a publicly reachable address, at least initially. Today, I can say that most peer-to-peer tools come with extensions which help that situation at least a little bit. Like, for example, BitTorrent has some kind of local peer discovery through UDP broadcasts, which works even if you're not on the internet and makes local communication much faster than going through a gateway. So probably, I hope that a more recent impression might help you to reconsider your prejudices about peer-to-peer technology. So, coming to an example, what is Gnunet? It's a general-purpose modular peer-to-peer framework written in C. It's really old. It's been a research project for about 12 years now. After some point, when it started to work a little bit, and it looked like this 1990s GTK application, but it didn't work well. It crashed a lot. Then in 2008, they announced they're going to rewrite it from scratch. And then I thought, okay, guys, I'm out. See you in a couple of years, maybe. So now, recently, the fog has lifted, and this rewrite has been a pretty successful story. Gnunet is now truly modularized, which means it's a set of services communicating through local Unix domain sockets. You don't need all of them. You can choose which exact components you want to use on a specific system for the tasks this system needs to do. It provides a DHT-based overlay network with cryptographic identifiers. So pretty much what you could also do with TOX or CGDNS. Just like Gnunet has a lot of different transports. It doesn't rely on only one transport mechanism, but it can transport through UDP, through TCP. It can mimic HTTP client and server transports. It even has a true HTTPS transport, which you could even equip with true HTTPS certificates, which would make deep packet inspection and filtering of the traffic pretty impossible. And I've been to that situation a lot, that I've been sitting in the airport, and you know, they gave me that free internet, so I want to use it to SSH into a system at home, but then I realized they block SSH. They only allow port 80 and port 443 and DNS, and that's it. So Gnunet had that in mind and created nice tools to still punch through the firewall in a similar way Skype did it in earlier days, and I think they now do everything centrally through their Microsoft server, but at least a while ago they did it in a similar way, and it was probably inspired by that. So if you want to know more about the technical and science background on Gnunet, there are loads of papers. Like, the key developer of Gnunet happens to be a science research group leader in a popular university, so all his student homeworks... Huh? At Technical University of Munich. Munich, yeah. So all the student homeworks in the realm of distributed systems or peer-to-peer, he happens to give them tasks which end up to be contributions to Gnunet or bug fixes or reviewing, and also writing a lot of master and PhD theses about that. So we end up with a lot of theoretical information. If you want to, it's all there. And there's also some mostly up-to-date documentation on the website regarding the actual implementation. I say mostly up-to-date because a project going on for 12 years, you need to decide smartly when to throw away which part of the documentation, because it's just not true anymore. So this is also the weeding of this documentation wiki is a major task which is a bit neglected. But it's still kind of okay. There are some things which are not accurate anymore, but most of it is more or less up-to-date. And there is lots of code. And the code itself is pretty, like, during the rewrite, it was polished a lot. Like, it all has doxygen comments. It's readable code. They have nice style rules in terms of indention and how to write readable code. Though in the beginning it might be a bit tricky because they have like because it's supposed to be portable. So they wanted to compile on Windows, on Android, and on various Linux C libraries. So they need some kind of abstraction layer, and also you need the common dynamic structures like a linked list or something, which you just don't have a standard implementation in the C library. So they came up with something called Gnunet Util, which is a common library used by all Gnunet services, which provides serialization, deserialization, and you know, dynamic structures and stuff you need, but you wouldn't find in a typical standard C library. So my idea was Gnunet would be very valuable for me to run on embedded systems. This is where we come back to the light switch. Because in that way, I could have Internet of Things devices which are available in a peer-to-peer fashion without the need of all this ugly port forwarding UPnP madness. And I don't have to rent a server just to have a light switch. So that was the motivation. I didn't really care about the initial purpose of Gnunet, which is file sharing, and because obviously that's too big for a small device, but just having a useful overlay with a lot of transports, that sounded like something which could be very, very useful also on small devices for remote management or for low bandwidth tasks and which go through every firewall in the world. Yeah? Can you pass the microphone maybe?
You mentioned a DHT-based overlay. So does Gnunet communication follow the existing links and routes of a network, or does it jump in a based on a hash of the target randomly between the nodes before finding a target? Because
I would like to postpone that question because I'm going to come to the routing later. If that's okay for you, maybe in two or three slides, we will have the answer to that anyway. Anyway, so I started porting Gnunet to OpenWRT for Battlemesh last year. My original intention was to see if the routing algorithms in Gnunet, I knew that they couldn't, but at least to see like to which degree they would not be able to compete to what we usually see here, which is all a performance-focused show basically. So, but I would want to see, like, is it 100 times worse or 1,000 times worse or 10,000 times worse? And the conclusion was that in the beginning, back then in 2015, it kind of didn't work at all, because there were also in Gnunet a lot of assumptions which would contradict my understanding of how to design distributed systems. For example, Gnunet has the assumptions that all clocks are synchronized, because public key certificates have a validity time, and the validity time, it's given in like absolute planetary time, and so you need either NTP or an RTC or whatever, some source and access to a trusted centralized time, which is a whole different problem for itself they didn't solve, unfortunately. I hope that there will be like a time synchronization module for Gnunet, because it's also a very fundamental thing which is missing right now, like a distributed version of NTP. If anyone knows good papers or research in that direction, I'd be very happy to hear more about that. So during the porting, I had to take care of Gnunet's giant configuration infrastructure and the giant amount of different services for different purposes. So I created a total of 20 modules apart from the core package for all the different things you can do, which range from things like key value storage, like CouchDB, up to I want to start an audio conversation with another node and I will use Pulse Audio for that or something. And of course includes all the file sharing and tunneling of existing traffic like to the internet or to the ARPA internet through Gnunet, but also using legacy IP version X applications to access services on Gnunet, similar to like Tor hidden services. The concept is pretty much the same. This is integrated by, usually on other Linux distributions, you would have a name service switch, so you could like nicely type your host name, which you gave to a certain peer in the Gnunet name system. But as OpenWRT is not based on glibc, it doesn't have a name service switch. So I ended up using a tricky DNS interception method to integrate the Gnunet name system, which still, I believe it could be done better, but it works sometimes. Then, of course, the file sharing things, they all work. I tried, and it's impressive that it works. The file sharing Gnunet could be interesting for embedded systems, for system upgrade capabilities, or serving package lists, or all these services where we currently rely in central web servers to deliver software, because Gnunet allows creating private namespaces for like directories, basically, and the owner of the directory can also update a file or add another file to a shared directory, which ends up to be a URL. So that could be a package list, for example, and then you would just upload your packages and they would be stored with those peers which offer storage backend, which they don't need to. You can totally run Gnunet without a storage backend and then it doesn't offer that. As I said, audio conversation even works. Now I prepared a little screencast showing you just practically what does it look like, how does that feel inside the OpenWRT shell, and I hope that I'll be able to move it over to that screen. Yeah, here we go. Let's see, here we are. So this, I instantiated a bunch of nodes in virtual machines. This is the first one. This is probably the second one. Yeah, that's the third one. So I hope that now that I unplugged the Ethernet cable from my laptop, they will still be able to communicate. First of all, let's see that. I hope they will. No, they don't. That's very sad, probably because we don't have an address at all. Yeah, it looks like we didn't get an address. That's very bad. Yeah, Gnunet creates a maximum of 3 different TUN interfaces for different purposes. The VPN interface, it has an address range of your choice, version 4, version 6. You can set it up pretty arbitrarily. This is if you want to access a service on Gnunet using a legacy IPvX application. Then you query the domain name of that service, and the query will create a mapping of an address within that range. So that address will be returned. So when you open a socket to that address, it will be routed to that interface, and then you'll be able to access the service. The exit interface is just the other side of that. This is where if you offer a service or if you offer connectivity to the public internet, then the traffic sent by other nodes to you will come out of the exit interface with the addresses you specify. So that could even be globally routed IP version 6 addresses, then you don't need a NAT and people can transparently access the V4 and V6 internet, which is something I tested a little bit and it works. Sometimes it even offers a very interesting address translation mechanism, which is that you could have a service which is IP version 4 only, and you have a client application which is IP version 6 only. So I can set the service up in a way that it connects to an IP version 4 address in a certain TCP or UDP port, and I can set the VPN client in a way that it wants to open a version 6 socket, and Gnunet will do the translation between V4 and V6, which obviously is nice for legacy services or legacy clients. So maybe, I don't know, if you have the patience for it, I try to get them to connect. Basically, what I wanted to show is that there's a command, which is another way to set up, where is it? Maybe it's still there, no. There's another command to set up a VPN mapping, and then you can connect to it, and it will allow the two nodes to communicate. I think currently it's failing because I don't have any useful address left now that I unplugged the Ethernet cable, because unfortunately they don't allow doing it only through the link local. Yeah, and currently I have only a link local address, so that's the reason it doesn't work. Probably we shift that to the end, and then people still interested, we can do that in a smaller... You believe it works, that's great. Good. So what's the future? What will be added? Now what we got is an overlay. It provides file sharing capabilities. It provides tunneling of all sorts of traffic. It allows to have secret services, hidden services, which are not that hidden on Gnunet. It's hard to compare it with Tor. But Gnunet itself came up with an onion routing application, a service which does onion routing on top of Gnunet, which is brilliant. But also, as we know now, onion routing is not really the last answer to all privacy needs, because if you have a powerful player observing the whole onion, then it's still very easy to de-anonymize users by traffic shaping or by just observing the bandwidth patterns. As you all know, like a download never runs in the same speed, so this fingerprint is still visible on both ends, no matter how much of a complicated knot you have in between. There's also lots of things about routing which will still come up. I don't know why I didn't put it on the next slide. Never mind. So the future, what's currently being developed, is there's a pops-up kind of API, which they call the social API. So this will allow you to set up emitters of events, and it has kind of a multicast routing scheme, so these events would be routed to the subscribers. This can be private, they call it places, or public places, which everyone can enter. You could easily, you know, use that to create services which will on the surface look like something as Twitter or WhatsApp, with like multi-user semi-offline chat and content linking capabilities combined with the file sharing layer. There's also already like a multi-user IRC-like chat being developed, and it's based on top of that. It's a nice CLI thing. And what's also very interesting, there's the consensus voting and contract system. This is like a Byzantinous consensus thing, which is very similar to what you probably know from Ethereum as the most popular project in the field. So Gnunet basically just ate all the papers they wrote and built it on top of their own peer-to-peer framework system. And this allows creating microcurrencies or online currencies. But it would also allow, like, which is interesting for mesh communities, having a consensus about, for example, transport encryption. So this could be a way to agree on a PSK2 keys on top of some ad hoc networks, for example. And as Gnunet has its own Wi-Fi transport, which is very slow, but uses injection mode, it doesn't depend on a previous successful association or any kind of network interface already being operating. You just have a monitor interface, Wi-Fi-wise, and do injection. So it's going to be horribly slow, but it's good enough for a handshake to set up the keying afterwards being used on an ad hoc interface or an 802.11s interface, which I think that would, it would be great to have that as a general purpose tool to set up PSK2 in a smart way for each individual peer and not as a shared key for the whole network, but on an association base. But that's not implemented anywhere, unfortunately. What they also came up with, due to a lot of demand and nobody felt really comfortable with it, but it came up in the end, is a RESTful API. That's basically HTTP services which you communicate with using JSON. So this allows you, if you run your local Gnunet peer, to have rapidly prototyped applications using the web browser running on top. I'm not really a big believer in a web browser philosophy. It's kind of something I'd want to get rid of, but I can see that it's a tool which currently allows a lot of rapid prototyping, so it might be an interesting solution. What I'm hoping for Gnunet's embedded future is I will write a lot of more documentation, because I got to a point where a lot of things like the tunneling of services starts to work, or that you can use Gnunet for naming and as a better option compared to DNS. So I will write nice. What happened? Okay. What was that? Yeah? Okay. So yeah, I will write more documentation to make it possible for everyone to easily test that. And I would really invite everyone to even contact me and bug me as much as you want. If you want to test and see how to get that started, I'm very open for that, and I'm willing to spend lots of time to get more people involved. Because currently, like the whole last year, maybe two people were interested in it and like tried it a little bit, but I lost them somewhere on the way because things did not work well enough at that stage. But right now I can see that if there is a bug, then it's a bug in Gnunet and we should fix it. And by now I also, you know, I've been in touch with that code base for 2 years, so I feel confident enough to be able to help you if you run into trouble. I also want to further split things, because the Gnunet core package is still about 800 kilobytes in size, and it depends on GNU TLS, which is another 400 kilobytes, which is, I believe, too large to only provide the overlay functionality. That should be possible with about half of the size. And I think it's possible by just further splitting up the core package.
Use it.
The application. Yeah, I think it's perfect for remotely managing small devices which are otherwise hidden behind firewalls or routers without setting up things like port forwarding or DIN DNS, because it's just much smoother. And
well, I tested the last half a year a thing that calls zero tier.
Yeah, that's another overlay.
So that will be a little bit an idea like this.
Exactly. Gnunet can provide exactly the same what zero tier or CGDNS could provide you as well. More beyond that. And I think, you know, most of the overlay networks which provide you IP on top of IP, by repeating the paradigms used by IP, you kind of also, without needing to repeat the mistakes, which we know, like IP version 4 is like something from, like for me, it's something from like 1965. So why do we imitate that if we don't even gain the performance we could have? Like, I understand it if it's all remains inside kernel, but if you do an overlay in user space, there's no need to, you know, feed it back into the kernel and pretend that it's IP version 4. Why would we do that? It's a very common API is the answer. But I think applications in distributed context should go beyond that and also need a lot of context from neighboring layers, which is the problem of a layered network model, that it's always tricky to get information from the neighboring layers.
Okay, just to help me out, if I'd like to test it, you say just to test it. So keep it on a smaller level, to say if I gonna implement this technically running in an open WRG, and to say I would be very happy to have the function like zero tier, which works very nice, to test this for the scope, solely for the scope, to have the same functionality. That would for me make sense in a testing environment.
Yeah.
You know, if that helps up like a testing, I would be in.
Great.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
So yeah, more volunteers are definitely needed. For whatever you want to use it for. Not necessarily also only routers, but you can use OpenWRT on a lot more different systems. We need people who run exit nodes towards the public internet. We need to test the onion routing service, which has probably not been tested at all by anyone by now. So, but it's, yeah, I suppose so. No. It's not just my work at all. I just joined the development about 2 years ago throughout a journey I had through all different overlay and distributed application frameworks. And I got stuck there because, it's written in C. It kind of looks like it could run on OpenWRT. So I thought that that's the smartest thing to get into after a long evaluation. Why are they doing this injection-based stuff? Because previously, there was a way to set up the rate during transmission. And also they thought that, it's smart to have a way for clients in vicinity to communicate without needing to be connected to the same access point. So if they're just on the same channel, and some many access points, like in universities, I think that's the scenario they were probably facing, they have client isolation switched on. So client isolation prevents direct communication between the clients. And injection was the only way they saw to go around it. I don't think it's very smart, but 10 years ago it was probably a good idea. And by now, maybe ad hoc mode, peer-to-peer probably not, but or 11S could be used instead, or as an addition after having set up this injection-based interface and having exchanged or agreed on credentials, then a faster transport could be set up using those credentials. But this is something we need to implement. If anyone wants to join that effort, I'd be very happy. So what's the routing scheme of Gnunet, which comes back to your previous question? They have a DHT-based routing scheme, which is called CADET, and it's really just a DHT. So there's no metric apart from is it available or is not available. So it might take very long or unfortunate routes in a mesh environment where not every node can see every other node. In order to help that situation, they also created their own distance vector-based routing transport. It's called DV. I had a look at the code. It's not a lot. And whoever is into designing routing protocols, I'd really appreciate common review or comments on that, because I think it's not been worked on a lot. It kind of works. I tested it, and it really, it creates a metric that, this peer is reachable through that peer, and the metric is bandwidth estimation, which I think is, it's a current trend, but I've been working on bandwidth estimation-based metric in a commercial context, and I saw that it's not actually that terribly smart. Or it has its difficulties as well, and Gnunet currently doesn't address them. They have toy figures for the estimated bandwidth most of the time, which leads to route flapping and all sorts of problems. So also their help would be needed. Here's some online resources. The top one is just the Gnunet homepage, and then I created a OpenWRT package feed for OpenWRT, the Chaos Karma release and follow-up releases, because the Gnunet packages are already part of the OpenWRT packages set by now. But when I started porting, which was already after the release of Chaos Karma, the first 15.05 version, they couldn't be merged into the packages for 15.05, obviously. So also, Gnunet is not part of the 15.05.1 more recent release. But if you want to test it, this is an OpenWRT package feed, and you will see on GitHub that there's two branches. The master branch is just the normal package feed, and there's a branch binaries, which currently contains precompiled binaries you can just install on a AR71XX-based systems. If you want binaries for other systems, I happily upload them as well. And SecuShare, as the last link, is the high-level application which currently evolves on top of Gnunet. It's less related to routers and small devices, but it's more something like a very cool instant messenger tool, which you know allows you to do something like you would usually do with WhatsApp or Jabber, let's say, but on top of Gnunet, completely decentralized with anonymity and privacy and security in mind. It works a little bit. It looks kind of, you know, the UI looks very similar to Talks, coincidentally. But I'd recommend you to try that. It's an interesting development to follow. I'm not so much of a user interface person, so I don't contribute a lot there, but I think it's a very interesting thing to look at. Yeah, and that was kind of it. Questions? More questions?
Can you pass the microphone? First of all, I want to congratulate you for the huge work. I wrote the IPv6 support for RetroShare, so I know what it means to develop something like that.
Yeah, I've been doing a lot of work on RetroShare as well. It's interesting. I tried to create RetroShare headless as one of the previous efforts to achieve something similar.
And I was curious about the SecuShare. What's the status right now? Because I've tried it like 2 years ago, and I like dedicated 4 days. I could not compile it, and I'm good at compiling.
There has been a lot of progress in the past year, basically. More people joined the development efforts, and there's a very focused, straightforward speccing, implementing, testing process, mostly by three active developers, I guess. And it became more or less usable, at least on Linux systems. You can have your roaster and start a chat or audio conversation using SecuShare. I think for the whole, like now the interesting thing would be I have a video and I want to share that with a friend, like the same way you would do it on Facebook. So the video has to be published into your private namespace file sharing wise, and then you would pops up, send out, broadcast or multicast the address to the link to all your friends. I don't think that this integration of multimedia content is working yet, but it could work very, very soon, because that's also just using the existing API and probably throwing stuff at GStreamer or whatever.
Okay. And I just wanted to ask about the use case. You specified the light switch, IoT area. Because before you were talking about the implementing of remote access to those devices without using DIN DNS or anything else. But what about the privacy issues of these devices, IoT? Do you work on that thing as well with Gnunet? Somehow limit the data that they're leaking to the cloud, or limiting the access to those devices?
Yeah. Basically, what you could do is to have devices configured in a way, obviously, that only you can access them and you don't need a central server as an intermediate party. And also, Gnunet, due to the transport not being transparent, you can, like on IP, usually the header doesn't change throughout all routes. So in Gnunet, there is no such a thing. You don't see the metadata in transit. You only see it on the two ends. And so this also disguises, because you know the light switch in your house, you're probably the only person in the world using it. So even if you would not go through a central server, the fact that you're opening a connection to that IP and that port on your router to set up this SSH tunnel or whatever, this still like disguises you being the only user of that service. And you know, in terms of location anonymity, that's very bad. So Gnunet can help you a little bit to go around it. It's not yet capable of you know, generating fake traffic, so traffic shaping based analysis would still make it obvious that if you do a lot of traffic, then which is the end it comes in and which is the end it comes out. Yeah. For that, we would like to implement more random padding or just randomly generating traffic. So the packet size is also changed on the way, so you could no longer match it. This has been worked on as part of this whole transport anonymity thing they call Brahms, which is the onion routing extension, which might also add things like random padding or random delays, which obviously is a high cost, but you know, if it's just about a light switch, you might not care about performance so much, but really have the slider on the security side.
But if we're talking about the IP cameras, for example, that's...
Sorry?
If we're talking about IP cameras or other IoT devices that have more information about you and you don't want to leak it, that would be a different case.
Not just, I didn't understand any word. Sorry, it's too noisy.
Yeah, if we're talking about different IoT devices that might leak more information than just a switch on or off, we might care about those accesses.
You mean like devices running proprietary software?
Yeah, exactly.
Like a camera or something?
Sure.
In that case, you could use Gnunet and set up a service which only allows you to access, for example, the web interface of a camera and just don't give that camera a default route. And, you know, that would obviously, you know, isolate it as well as it could be, unless the camera firmware knows an exploit in Gnunet.
Can you explain a little better how does the DHT-based routing work? Because I don't get if you mean routing, like routing to the ID of the resource that I'm looking for, or routing like in-network routing.
Basically, it just allows you to look up the cryptographic identity of a node and figure out what are the possible transports to get to it, which could be an intermediate hop using that has this distance vector transport, then it could be an intermediate hop in between. But basically it's...
So it's routing, meaning that with the DHT you identify the resource. Where is the IP, the final IP of the resource that you want to connect to?
Sorry?
Which is the final IP of the resource you want to connect to? Then you use any shortest path routing that the network is giving you to go the shortest path to that resource.
Exactly, yeah.
So when you were talking about the onion routing, this is another thing. It's on top
exactly.
of this,
no, that's
you can
an application
have
running on top if you want to. It's not. It's like just another service, basically. You could have this onion routing service which will provide you an onion routing transport, and then you could like make sure to route your things through that transport, and then that would provide.
And is the network topology like available somehow? That can I, if I join the DHT, map the whole DHT somehow? Can I reconstruct the topology of the whole GNUnet network?
It's not that much right now, so it's very obvious, because you know it will be more difficult from a certain point on, because right now the amount of peers you have on GNUnet is so small that your local cache of peers will contain every peer there is, because usually there's about 12. So, anonymity in that sense is also very theoretical, obviously.
But in general, like if you use CAD, Cadimlia or CAD or whatever, they are based on a DHT, which supposedly you do not know the full DHT. But if you start sampling it...
I can hardly hear you, sorry.
You can actually sample a DHT. Like in CAD, you have IDs of nodes. You do not know the full network, but you can start sampling the full DHT.
Yeah.
You brute force it, and in the end, you find all the resources in the network.
You would find all the nodes in the network, not all the resources. Because I was confused by that in the beginning, too, because I thought, you know, anonymity also means hiding the fact that I use GNUnet at all, which is what GNUnet doesn't do. Because there's a clear separation between what is a node which communicates on a public network and also wants to announce its presence for others to connect to, which don't necessarily have anything to do with you on a social human layer. So the user and the node are two different concepts which hardly touch each other. So it's very hard to map which user is sitting on which node. That's another story. But it's very easy to map all the nodes. Does that answer your question?
Have in mind how DHT work with P2P, and that there is not such distinction. The DHT maps nodes and resources at the same time. They are in the same DHT.
Not necessarily.
So this is working differently.
No, in Gnunet, these are different DHTs. And the access to the, you know, a transport DHT to just, you know, make a discovery option to see can we connect, is obviously run on top of the traditional ARPA internet, so you would be able to discover other nodes while being connected to the ARPA internet. While other service DHTs are storage systems for messaging or file sharing, and you know, there's lots of applications for DHTs in there, obviously. They work on top of the Gnunet transports. So, you know, scanning through that will be much harder because you would have to scan through the whole key space.
Yeah, but DHT are organized in a way that you can sample them, and you do not know where all the resources are, but you know how to find them. But anyway, that's just details.
Yeah, I didn't understand the question fully. Sorry.
Oh, I just wanted to add that I think that Cadet doesn't always do shortest routing. It does some form of randomization to circumvent SIBL attacks, mainly. So it does a random route first, and then once it can establish some good connections, it optimizes, I believe.
I think so, yeah. I haven't looked much into the details of the DHT implementation, but I know that it's heavily celebrated by people who are dealing with that stuff.
When you have a P2P network, you have this overlay, and the more it is randomized, the better it works in general. But when you move it to a community network, then this translates into the fact that if you have a peer that it's your network, your neighbor in the physical network, since the overlay is randomized and you want to go there, you will actually move around the whole community network to go there.
So So because of that, in addition to the DHT-based lookup routing, basically, you also have the distance vector transport, which will just show you who you could reach directly or indirectly in your local environment based on, you know, on the number of hops, basically.
So, which makes the overlay topology somehow predictable?
Yeah.
Okay.
If you use that transport.
Okay.
Which you would only use if you are inside a mesh network or a large local area network like a university, then that probably makes sense to use it. If you're just on the public internet, it doesn't make a difference, obviously. Yeah, thank you very much. One more question?
In the DHT is usually vulnerable to poisoning attacks. And in fact, in RetroShare, we use a DHT. But we take in account that DHT can be poisoned.
Yeah.
So we use PGP keys, we verify that the answer given by the DHT is true or not.
Yeah. Gnunet does something similar. The routing the DHT algorithm they use is called R5N. So if you look up that, you'll find the details. They also considered the option of various attacks, including this famous cyber attack, and found ways to mitigate it by harvesting from the PKI infrastructure they already got, basically, and by randomization.
Okay. Another question I do add is that in RetroShare you do low level connection only to trusted peers.
Yeah.
And then you can get, for example, a shared file also from an unknown person through turtle routing.
Yeah.
In Gnunet, if I remember well, it by default connect also to untrusted people, but you can configure it.
You can switch it to a friend-to-friend only mode.
Okay.
Right.
But in the case you switch to only friend-to-friend, you have some kind of routing. You can get shared content also from unknown people through the other peers.
Indirectly, yeah, if they are not in friend-to-friend mode as well. You need like an intermediate as a friend, which is not operating in friend-to-friend mode himself.
Okay, but if there is a path of friend-to-friend, I'm friend with you, you are friend with him, and him is friend with him.
Yeah, that works. That will work too. That will work. That's the idea, yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Thank you.
Yeah, if there are no more questions, that will be the end of that session. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope it was inspiring. To me, this is a very experimental field, so I wouldn't recommend, you know, basing your productive system on any of those overlays networks today. And we might not have seen the final implementation whatsoever. However, I found it very enlightening to start playing with those technologies because it's eye-opening to see that there's a reality which could allow us to have truly autonomous and distributed services which will survive net splits, which will survive failing default routes, and still give us valuable daily life communication services. And I hope that I inspired some of you to consider contributing or getting into that, no matter which application or which implementation you prefer. I just believe it's a great field of research, and thank you for your attention.